Hi and welcome. Today we continue our discussion of the standard model, okay, we're going to actually construct for the first time in these lectures what is the Lagrangian of the standard model. But first of all, we need to discuss how to include quarks in all the machinery that we have been mounting in the last few weeks. Okay, so let me go back to the case of the neutron decay, right? We saw how to analyze the muon decay, and we got to the conclusion that actually the right theory that is able to reproduce Fermi theory in the muon decay at low energy is the following, is SU2 left cross U1 hypercharge, spontaneously broken to electromagnetism. And we know that this spontaneous breaking, this electroweak symmetry breaking, is mediated by a Higgs double H, okay? Now, what about neutron decay or beta decay? So you remember that beta decay was this process. The neutron decays into a proton, an electron, and an antineutrino of the electron, okay? So let's write down the diagram of this object. So it is this one. So we have a neutron and a proton here, and then we have the lepton part, so this is an electron, and this is the antineutrino of the electron. So notice that I'm taking all momenta outgoing here, and that's why this is an antineutrino, because the arrow on the fermion line is pointing in the direction which is opposite to the momentum direction, okay? Now, you remember that this was also describable by a four Fermi Lagrange, a four fermion interaction, a dimension six operator. And we said that experimentally the coefficient was exactly the same as in the case of muon decay. Okay, so how shall we move on? We know that the neutron and protons are bound states of quarks. So let's try to analyze what happens from the point of view of quarks. Okay, and then we will make an assumption and continue from there. So let's remind ourselves that the neutron is a bound state of two down quarks and an up quark. Okay, you remember it's completely asymmetric in flavor. And the proton, sorry, in color, completely asymmetric in color. And the proton is one down quark and two up quarks. Okay, so if I look at this process in which a neutron turns into a proton plus something else, you see that this part. This leptonic part is not interfering with the quarks here. It's something which is leptonic, so it's completely separated. You see that actually what happens is that one down quark turns into an up quark. Okay. The other two, the down and up remaining, are called spectators. Okay. So we can actually modify this Feynman diagram to take into account this process at the level of quarks. So here I have a down quark that becomes an up quark, and the other two, which is a down quark and an up quark, do not do anything, so they are spectators. So this down remains a down, this up remains an up. Okay, so this is the process at the level of quarks. So you see that actually the only part of this process that we need to describe is this one. So the current here will be the following, will be something like this. So let me write again our Fermi constant. Then we will have our leptonic part. So let me write it here. This is E bar left, gamma alpha nu E left. Okay. So we know that this part is V minus A, so it contains only the left-handed spinors. Now, what about the quark part? Well, you remember that at the level of neutron and proton, we had a strange factor, 1.2 something, that was modifying, that was deforming the interaction from a pure V minus A interaction. So what we're going to say, what we're going to suppose, is that actually that factor different from one is due to strong interactions. And at the level of quarks, what we have here is a pure V minus A interaction of this type. Okay. So of course, once more, I know that I'm being repetitive, but this is a very important point. This is just an hypothesis. Ultimately, only data can confirm if this is true or not. The data that we have collected in the last 40 years seems to confirm that actually, even at the quark level, the weak interactions only see the left-handed spinners. Okay, so it's a universal property, which is independent on the fact that we're talking about quarks of leptons. And as we're going to see, actually, we partially see discussing muon decay, it's also independent from the generation. Okay, so the same type of structure will be repeated for every possible generation. So here we can take a charm quark and a strange quark, or a top quark and a bottom quark. And again, the type, the chirality of the spinor entering this weak interaction will always be the left-handed one. Okay. So this is the Lagrangian that is describing beta decay. Okay, so we have a leptonic part and we have a quark or hadronic part. So we already know that this can be described in terms of a lepton doublet, which if you remember, we defined to be this object here. Now you see that the structure is completely identical to this one, just that instead of taking an electron and a neutrino, we are taking an up quark and a down quark. Notice that the same relative difference in the charge that we have between the electron and the neutrino, which is minus one between the neutrino and the electron, if you want, this is electric charge zero, this is electric charge minus one, can be repeated here, right? The up quark has an electric charge of 2/3, the down quark has electric charge of minus 1/3. So you see that the difference is always equal to minus one. Right. So this means that by analogy, I can describe the left-handed quarks introducing a doublet that I'm going to call capital Q, and that I'm going to define in the following way. I have U left in the upper component and E left in the lower component. So you see that I'm always consider this is largely a matter of convention. Okay, wouldn't change anything. Wouldn't change if inverting these two entries. But the convention that we normally use is to put the particle with the largest charge in the first entry and with the lowest charge in the second entry. Okay. Here, since this has charge minus one, the largest and the largest charge is zero. Here is plus 2/3. Okay. What about right-handed particles? Well, we know that at the level of leptons, the right-handed electron is a singlet. Okay, so let me remind you the transformation, the representation. So this is a doublet with hypercharge minus 1/2. This is a singlet with hypercharge minus 1. This one will be a doublet. Okay, so Q is a doublet by construction. What is the hypercharge? Well, you can easily convince yourselves using the argument of the last lecture that the correct hypercharge here is 1/6, okay, with our convention. What about the right-handed quarks? Well, your right will be a singlet of SU2 with hypercharge plus 2/3, and the right will also be a singlet under SU2 because it's a right-handed fermion, right, exactly as the right-handed charge lepton was a singlet. They do not, the right-handed spinors do not feel the weak interaction, the electric interactions, okay? And what about its hypercharge? Well, it must be equal to minus 1/3, right? You remember that for right-handed particles, the hypercharge must be equal to the electric charge by construction. For the left-handed particles, no, it's not so simple, but you can easily convince yourselves that this is the correct value, okay? Very good. So now let's construct finally the Lagrangian of the standard model. So what we're going to use in our standard model are these particles here. So let me write them again so that we can appreciate the standard model in all its glory. So let's write the particle content. Of the standard model. Okay, so let's start with the scalar sector. Right. The scalar sector is given by the Higgs doublet, which is a doublet with hypercharge plus one up. Okay. Actually, let me extend now this group, because remember that now we're talking about quarks. So we also need to include the color. So let me write here that we have the color symmetry times the electroweak one. And what is left unbroken is color. Remember that the gluons remain massless. Okay, so color must be unbroken times electromagnetism. So you see that in this mechanism of electroweak symmetry breaking, the color symmetry is spectator, is not affected in any way. Okay. And let me also modify here a bit the notation for this representation. So a generic field, now I will denote in the following way. The representation under color, the representation under SU2 left, and its hypercharge. Okay, so let me change slightly the notation to make clearer what is going on. So let's start with the Higgs. So this is the bosonic sector. So we have the Higgs doublet. So this transforms as a singlet under color because it's uncharged, it doesn't transform. It is a doublet under SU2 left, and it has a hypercharge plus one half. Then let's go to the fermionic sector. And here we have all the fermions of our field. Okay, so let's start with the leptons. So in the lepton sector, we know that we have the lepton doublet. So the lepton doublet is a singlet under color, a doublet under SU2, and it has hypercharge minus one half. And we also have the right-handed charged lepton, which is again a singlet under color. It is a singlet under SU2 left, and it has hypercharge minus one. Okay. And now let me also introduce the fact that we have three generations. So let me put here an index I, where this I takes values 1, 2, 3, and this is referring to the different generations. Okay, so the representations are the same for every generation. So same representations for every generation. So we already had a first contact with this, because you remember that in describing muon decay, we actually had two currents, right, with two lepton doublets. So one was the electron, the neutrino of the electron, the electron, and the other one was the neutrino of the muon, the mu. Okay, and you see that exactly the same kind of structure was repeating itself. And here, that's the formalization of what we were starting to see in muon decay. So independently on the generation, the structure or the representations of these objects will also be the same. Okay, so let me be extremely explicit just for this lecture. So this L, so let me write it up here. In the first generation is neutrino of the electron left, electron left. Okay, so now this E represents the electron, not a generic charged lepton. I know that the notation the first time is confusing, but then with time you will see that you will get used to it. The second generation is the neutrino of the muon left, muon left. And the third generation is the neutrino of the tau left, tau left. Okay. So this is explicitly what this index I means in the case of the lepton doublet. And then for the right-handed charged lepton, we just have the electron right, the muon right, and the tau right. Okay. So this is the leptonic sector. Let's go to the quark sector. So in the quark sector, we have the quark doublet, which is a triplet under color. We're talking about quarks, so they're triplet under colors. A doublet under SU2, and it has hypercharge plus 1/6. And again, we have an index I here, denoting the generation. Okay, so again, we're gonna see that the same representation will be valid for every generation. Okay, so if you want, the technical way of saying this is to say that gauge interactions are flavor blind. They do not see the difference between the particles due to the particles belonging to different generations. Okay, so they're blind to flavor, and that's why we call them flavor blind. Then we have the right-handed quarks, which are the right-handed up quark, which is a triplet under color, a singlet under SU2, and it has hypercharge 2/3. And then we have the right-handed down quark, which are again triplets under color, singlets under SU2, and they have hypercharge -1/3. So actually this comment extends also to quarks. Okay, so this is the whole particle content of the standard model. Notice that I'm not including the gauge bosons in the particle content, because you see, once I give you these numbers, then how the gauge bosons enter into the game, it's completely fixed by the gauge symmetry. We don't have any freedom anymore, okay? And we know, in more specifically, that these gauge bosons will have kinetic terms, as we want them, and they will enter only through the covalent derivatives, right? Is that is the construction that allows us to actually make sense of this gauge symmetry. And then we know that somehow the Higgs boson will have to get a VEV, because we need to give mass to the W's and the C bosons, right? And this is what we're going to see today. So let's start writing down the standard model Lagrange. Okay, so I'm going to cancel this particle content, but this is something that you really should know by heart. This is the most fundamental thing that you can know about the standard model, because from here, you really can reconstruct everything. Okay, so let's see how we can reconstruct everything from here. So I'm going to split the standard model Lagrange in three pieces. It's going to be clear in a moment why these three pieces. Okay, so the game that I'm going to play now with all this particle content is precisely the same game that we played in the last lecture. So we just write down all possible invariants. Okay, there is going to be one invariant that is going to surprise us, but we're going to discuss it next lecture. Okay, not today, but I'm going to write it down in any way, in any case, and I'm going to point it out to you so that you're aware that there is an invariant that we never saw before. Okay, so the standard model Lagrangian is the four. So let me actually four pieces, okay? One will be trivial. So let me write here that this is, there is a first piece, which is the gauge part. Then there is the fermion part. Then there is the Higgs Lagrange. And then there is something that we are gonna call the Yukawa Lagrange. Okay, so these are the four terms that I'm now gonna open. So let's start with the L gauge. So L gauge is the simplest one. This is just given by the kinetic terms of the gauge boson. So this is -1/4 g mu nu a square for the gluons, -1/4 w mu nu a square for the w's, -1/4 b mu nu square for the b bosons. Okay. Then if you want here, you can also add the gauge fixing Lagrange. Okay, we didn't discuss how gauge fixing worked in the case of spontaneous symmetry breaking. This is something which is a bit more technical. Maybe we will discuss it in one of the next lectures. Otherwise, I simply suggest you have a look in any book of quantum field theory. Okay, it's not going to be extremely relevant for our discussion, but it's something that it's if you really want to do research in particle physics, you should know. So I'm not gonna actually go through it right now, but maybe in the future I will get back. There is also another piece in this gauge Lagrange that we actually never mentioned, which is the so-called ghost piece. Okay, so this is something that is a bit more technical in a sense. So we need to guarantee gauge invariance and unitarity of this theory when we introduce non-abelian symmetries, then we need to add some artifacts, which are called ghosts, in our Lagrange. They are very strange objects because they are scalar fields which actually obey the fermionic statistics. Okay, so you see that they cannot be something physical. So they're there because we need, there are processes, loop processes, in which just considering this, the Lagrangian as I wrote it, we see that we lose gauge invariance and unitarity. Okay, so they're there to actually take care of this void problem. Then if you approach the quantization of these theories via the path integral, then it's absolutely obvious why this ghost should appear through the Fadeev-Popov technique. Okay, so this is just for those of you who already know what the Fadeev-Popov technique is. Otherwise, just be aware that there is something else at this level that we are hiding under our carpet. And luckily, in this course, that won't play any role. But if you have to do more serious technical computations, then you need to be aware that there is also a ghost Lagrangian here. Okay. So this is the gauge Lagrangian. Now let's go to the fermion. So the fermion Lagrangian is the following. So let me write it in the following way, very schematic. So this is the sum over all the fermions of the theory, where the fermions are the following: the lepton doublet of all the generations, the right-handed charge doublet of all the generations, the quark doublet of all the generations, the right-handed up-type quark and the right-handed down-type quark of all the generations. Okay, so I'm summing over all these fermions the following kinetic term, F bar I capital D slash F, where this covariant derivative must be adapted to the fermion to which we are applying it. Okay, so I'm gonna write explicitly all the covariant derivatives for you to see how they work once in your life, okay? And then we're gonna try to discuss general properties of this covariant derivative. Before doing that, let me write the two remaining pieces. So the Higgs Lagrangian is very simple. It just contains the kinetic term of the Higgs, which again, since the Higgs has a non-trivial transformation rule under the symmetry, it must be a covariant derivative. And then we have the potential. And we're going to discuss later on what happens with this potential. And then we have the Yukawa Lagrangian, which is given by the following terms. So it's minus L bar I YE I J H E right J minus Q bar I Y D I J H D right J minus Q bar I Y U I J H tilde U right J. So this is the new invariant I was mentioning, because it involves this new object, H tilde. So this we're going to discuss next lecture, okay? And also, I'm going to tell you next lecture what these flavor indices refer to, okay? So this is the standard model of particle physics. Now, the rest of this course will be devoted to actually compute the consequences of this Lagrangian, okay? So what we're going to do today is to start with the fermion Lagrangian and see what happens to the fermion Lagrangian. Then we will move on and we will analyze the Higgs Lagrangian, okay? Leaving the Yukawa part for next lecture. So let's start. So this is just the kinetic term of the fermions. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna write for you explicitly all the covariant derivatives of the different terms. Once you understand how to do it, it's pretty obvious, but I think it's good since you're learning this subject, I think it's good for you to see them written explicitly. So let's start with the lepton doublet. Okay, so d mu applied on the lepton doublet is the following object. So we have the normal derivative, then we have the W's, and we know that here these W's, if you want, these generators are the sigma matrices divided by two, okay? Then we have the hypercharge, but the hypercharge, you remember that it's minus one half. So I'm gonna write it minus I divided by two, G prime B mu, and all this applied on that. Okay, so this is an identity. So remember that this is a two component object, right? So this is a 2x2 matrix, right? So fine, this can be applied here. This and this, I'm writing in them, these two terms, without any explicit matrix structure, but simply meaning that they are proportional to the identity when they act. Okay, so their action is equal for the two components of this lepton doublet. Now let's move on to the, and this is completely independent on the generation. So I can just put the index I there. And actually from now on, I won't even bother for this lecture to write down flavor index because the discussion is absolutely the same as we were saying for any generation. Now let's go with the covariant derivative of the right-handed charge vector. So this is d mu, the normal derivative. Then I do not have to put the SO2 left part because these are singlets, so they don't transform, they're transparent to the W bosons. I need to put the hypercharge, right? Since the hypercharge is minus one, here I get minus I G prime B applied on the right. Let's now go, and this is, so you see, this is the lepton sector. Now let's go, let's move on to the quark sector. So the quark sector is given by the following covariant derivative. So the usual derivative. Then I need to take into account that the quarks are triplets under color. So here I need to put I, G strong. Let me write them like this. G mu A T A color plus I G W mu A T A left plus I G prime over six B mu, all this apply on Q. And now we need to pay attention, okay, to what is going on here. So what is the meaning of this? So this is obvious, right? Because you see, this is just the identity applied on this quark tablet. So there is no way to, so this if you want, this term is applying in this, it's applied on the same way on all components that are included. Now, what about these two terms? This one we understand, right? Because these are the poly matrices applied on the tablet. So this is these are 2x2 matrices, and this is a two-component object. So it's clear how this object is applied here. But what about the color part? Because you see, there is also a color transformation. So what am I actually saying writing this covariant derivative like this? Well, what I'm actually saying is that this generator here is acting on the color indices of this quark, okay? So remember that this capital Q is U left, D left, right? And this is in the SU2 doublet space. But each one of these up and down quark carry an index, let me call it alpha, which can take values from 1 to 3, that denotes the color, because remember that each quark comes in 3 different colors, right? So this matrix here, I'm writing it on the same foot of the others, but what I mean here is that this matrix is acting on these indices alpha and not on the index of the doublet representation, okay? So this matrix is acting on the up quark, on the color of the up quark, mixing them up, and it's acting in the same way on the color indices of the down quarks, mixing them up, okay? So they do not, this color transformation does not mix the up with the down quark because it's transparent to the structure of the doublet, but it's mixing the quarks, the different color of the quarks one with the other, okay? So we won't ever write down explicitly the color indices here, the SU2 indices here, and so on, because it's annoying. But just keep in mind that it's important for you to know that the indices on which this index, this generator and this generator are acting are different. This one acts on the doublet indices, this one acts on the column indices. Okay. Let's move on. Covariant derivative of the right-handed up fork. So this is again d mu. And now what do I need to change? Well, this up fork of right-handed chirality is still a triplet of SU3. So I still have to put the strong interactions here. It is a singlet under SU2, so it doesn't see the Ws, but it has a non-vanishing hypercharge, which is equal to 2/3. So here I need to put plus I 2/3 G prime B. Ah, you know, you're right. Okay. So again, let me stress once more. You see that this B is acting on the same way on all the colors here. This T is actually mixing up the different colors of this quark. Okay. Now, finally, covariant derivative of the right-handed quarks. Normal derivative. They are again triplets of color. So the color part will stay the same. Again, they are singlets of SO2, so they are transparent to the Ws. They have hypercharge minus 1/3. So here I have minus I over 3, G prime, B, acting on Dirac. Okay. So these are all the covariant derivatives in the number. So when you need to open up explicitly the standard model Lagrange, these are the expressions that you need to consider. Okay. So now let me write the generic covariant derivative. Okay. So I will turn on all terms and let me write them in terms of the W plus and minus and of the Z boson and of the photon. Okay. So that we can discuss and understand what is the generic structure. So let me cancel here and let's see what we can say. So what I want to do is to try to write down a generic expression to understand how the various gauge bosons interact with the different fermions or with the different particles. Okay, because the same, exactly the same reason can be applied to the Higgs boson, to the Higgs particle. So the covariant derivative, the mu, we know that it's an operator which has one component which is given by the normal derivative. Then we should have the color, okay, but let me not write down the color because there is nothing interesting that can be said about color. We always have triplets, color is unbroken, so all the eight gluons will enter exactly with the same role. So it's just this term repeated over and over again, so I won't even bother writing it down, okay, but remember the four that works, here we also have the color. So let me just focus on the electroweak sector, okay. So here I have I, G, W A mu T A left plus I G prime Y B. Okay, so look that I'm not specifying what is the representation of this object. It can be a doublet, it can be a singlet. So let me write it simply as T left. And I'm also not specifying the hyperchart. Okay, so what am I gonna do now? Now I'm gonna write I'm gonna split up this term into these charge components and W3, and I'm gonna write W3 and B in terms of the physical Z and A bosons. Okay, so let's do it. So let me just focus. So let me put a parenthesis here. So I'm just gonna focus on this term here. Okay, so we already know the following, that from here we get G divided by square root of 2. W mu plus T plus left plus G divided by square root of 2 W minus T minus left. This is something that we already computed together. Okay, so now let's go to the neutral part. So we have G W3 mu T3 left plus G prime B mu Y. Okay. So the charge part is done. It's simply equal to this object here. Whatever the generators T plus and T minus are in the representation that you are considering. And now let's work a bit on the neutral path. Now we need to remember that this W is, so how to write this W in terms of Z and A, and how to write B in terms of Z and A. Okay, so let me just open up this one. So this term is going to G. Then W3, if you remember, is equal to the sine of the weak angle times A plus the cosine of the weak angle times Z. And then all these are seen T3 left. Okay. And then I have plus G prime. B is the orthogonal combination. So it's going to be equal to CW A minus SW Z. And then I have the hypercharge. Okay. And what I'm going to do now, I am going to collect the interactions with the photon and interactions with the Z boson and see what happens. So from here, I get G SW plus G prime CW times the photon. Okay. And if you remember, sorry, as usual, I forget the factors of T3 left and of Y. So let me rewrite it. So here I have T3 left plus G prime CW Y. And this is the photon. And then in the case of the Z, we have G CW T3 left minus G prime SW Y. All this going with the symbols. Okay. Now, if you remember what we said when we were discussing how electroweak symmetry is broken to the electric charge, you remember that SW is equal to G prime divided by the square root of G square plus G prime square, and CW is equal to G divided by the same square root. And then the electric charge was equal to T3 left plus Y. So if you now use these facts that we already know, you discover that this term is simply equal to E times Q times A, where I remind you that the electric charge in terms of G and G prime is given by GG prime divided by the square root of G square plus G prime square. Okay, remember that this is the prediction that we had of how to write the electric charge in terms of the gauge couplings of our gauge theory. So this term is exactly as we would get by construction. We're getting this because we're constructing this gauge theory to reproduce this term. Now, what's new is this term here. Okay, so let's open it up. So this is equal to G square divided by the square root of G square plus G prime square, and this goes with T3 left. Then I have minus G prime square, the hypercharge, and then I have Z. Okay, so let's work a bit more on this. Okay, so the part of the photon is obvious now, so let me write it up here. And let me keep it like that. So the part of the photon is precisely E, Q, A, nu. Now, what about the part of this? Well, we can rearrange a bit this expression to make it a bit clearer. Okay. And to make it a bit clearer, what I'm going to do is to trade this hypercharge for T3 left and the electric charge. Okay, so I will use this relation here to actually eliminate completely the hypercharge from this expression. Okay, so let's do it. So from here, you see that we have G square T3 left minus G prime square. Now, instead of Y, I write Q minus T3 left. So this is Q minus T3 left. And then everything is divided by the square root of G square plus G prime square. So you see immediately what is going on. Here I get a factor of g squared plus g prime squared, then multiplies t3 left. And then I get a factor of minus g prime squared q. All this divided by the square root of g squared plus g prime squared. So you see that this first term gets simplified with this denominator. And what we are getting is actually square root of g squared plus g prime squared, right? So here I will get the square root of g squared plus g prime squared proportional to t3 left. And then the second term is untouched, and it's g prime squared divided by the square root electric charge, okay? So you see that this one, this g prime, can be simplified if I use the definition of the sine of the weak angle from here. So if I write g prime as a sine times d square root, okay? So if I do this, what I get from here is a factor of this square root, which I can factorize completely. So this is g squared plus g prime squared. And then I'm left with t3 left minus the square of the weak angle times the charge, okay? So this is the term that sees the Z boson. So this is the coupling of the Z boson to the particles, okay? So you see that it's something a bit strange. So I'm gonna say a few more words about this in one moment. So let me write it up here. From here, I need to add plus square root of g squared plus g prime squared. And then I have t3 left minus sw squared times the electric charge times the z boson. Okay. And this is it. This is these are the possible interactions with the gauge boson. Okay, so let's have a look at this point. So these are exactly the ones that we might know. This is this also we know very well, right? Because this is just electromagnetism. Let's focus on the Z cap. So first of all, you see that the coupling strength is proportional to both the SU2 left gauge coupling and the hypercharge gauge coupling. Okay, so they both enter in determining the strength of the Z boson, exactly as it happens for the photon, right? This is why this is electroweak unification, because we are actually using two gauge coupling, GG prime, to express everything else. Now, what about this part? So you see that from here, we can gain a new insight of what this sine of the weak angle is. Because you see that if the sine of the weak angle were equal to zero, then the coupling of the Z boson would be exactly as those as the ones of weak interactions, right? It would be proportional to the P left projector, so it would be of type V minus A. So what the sine of the weak angle is doing is measuring the deformation of the Z coupling with respect to a pure V minus A coupling. Okay, so this is the effect of having the spontaneous symmetry breaking, which is mixing B and W3 to create the boson and the Z boson, the photon and the Z boson. And this is why this term is proportional to the electric charge. You see that this Z is seen the B minus A current plus a small piece of a current that should be seen by the photon. Okay, so this sine W is actually precisely what we were saying in one of the first previous lectures. It's measuring how much the physical states differ from W3 and B. Okay. Let me just anticipate that this sine square of W is experimentally more or less equal to 1.23. Okay, 0.1.23. So it's small, but it's not negligible. So really, there is a deformation of the Z coupling from the pure V minus A current. Okay, very good. So from here, we will actually get back to this Lagrangian in next lecture, because Once we consider the Yukawa Lagrangian, we will have to actually think about what the physical states are. Okay, but this is something that we can postpone to next lecture. The only thing that I want to tell you about this already now is one thing that you should be aware of. Because you see, what I said earlier is that the Fermion Lagrangian is equal to the sum of all the fermion states that I wrote of f bar I d slash f. And I didn't tell you anything about the flavor structure of this. So remember that gauge interactions are flavor blind, right? So a question, a natural question is, well, why don't I write a term like this in this Lagrangian? L bar I d slash L j with I and j different. So you see, this is completely gauge invariant, it's completely Lorentz invariant. So apparently it's a term that we can write in our Lagrangian. And here I put some matrix in this flavor space, which, because this term is Hermitian, must be Hermitian. Okay, so the term, so K, the matrix K, must be Hermitian. If you want to guarantee that the Lagrangian is Hermitian, so that ultimately the Hamiltonian is an observer. Now, why don't I write something like this? Well, why not? I mean, this is something that you can write, absolutely. We do not see this usually in our Lagrangian because we do something. We perform some rotation on this term in such a way to write it in a nice way. So let me show you why usually you don't see terms like this in your Lagrangian. So you see, K is Hermitian, right? So from your linear algebra, you know that the Hermitian, in any Hermitian matrix, can be diagonalized applying a unitary transformation. Okay, so I apply a unitary transformation on this Hermitian matrix, and I obtain something which is diagonal and positive. Okay, so all these terms are positive. So this is a diagonal, this is a 3x3 diagonal matrix in flavor space. So now remember that the fields are not observables, right? We have a freedom to redefine our fields. So what are we gonna do? Well, I'm gonna define new fields which englobe this U factor. So more specifically, let me write this in matrix term. So this is L bar K I d slash L. Now, K from here, I write as U, K diagonal, U dagger, and I insert here. So I get L bar U, K diagonal, U dagger, I d slash L. Now observe that this is constant. So you can go through the covariant derivative. And actually what I get here is I d slash U dagger L. And now I can redefine my lepton doublet or any field saying that L goes into U times F in such a way that this U dagger is eliminated because this U is unitary, and this U is also eliminated because here I have a dagger. Okay, so once I perform this field redefinition, I am left with L bar K diagonal I d slash L, which is better because now you see that this is diagonal, but it's still not in canonical form. Well, no problem, because now I can simply say, well, look, in flavor space, if I open up the indices, since this is a diagonal matrix, only the diagonal components II are different from zero, right? So only this term is different from zero. So you see that we have an improvement. Here, generic off-diagonal terms were turned on. Now only the diagonal ones are turned on. And now I redefine again my fields in the following way. The flavor I goes into itself divided by the square root of K diagonal II. So you see that if I perform now this redefinition, okay, everywhere, then this kinetic term becomes simply L bar I d slash L with indices II, which is of canonical form. Okay, So when we write down our standard model Lagrangian, when I write this term, I implicitly assume that I already perform all these transformations in such a way that I made canonical the kinetic terms over all the facts, okay? So this basis in Fregor space in which I perform all these redefinitions to get a canonical kinetic term is called the Fregor basis, okay? So this is the Fregor basis. Let me point out that in this basis, the fermions still do not have well-defined mass. Okay, we will discuss masses for fermions next lecture. So this is the Fregor basis is not the same one as the mass basis in which we can actually identify the fermion masses. So next lecture, we're gonna have to perform more field redefinitions to actually go to the physical basis. Okay, but keep in mind that the you can always achieve a canonical form for the kinetic terms applying this Fregor definition, since these are all field definitions that mix up Fregor indices. These are called Fregor definitions or Fregor transformations, and go into a basis in which this kinetic term is canonical. Okay. Very good. So now that we have discussed these things, let's quickly discuss the Higgs-Dapet segment. And in discussing the Higgs-Dapet sector, okay, I needed a formula, okay? I'm gonna write it down again. Let me cancel this one also. So let's discuss the Higgs-Lagrangian, which I remind you is equal to the mod square of the covariant derivative of the Higgs minus its potential. So from here, as we're going to see, we're going to compute Nw and Mz. And from here, we're going to compute the VEV and the Higgs particle mass. Okay, so let's start from here. So the covariant derivative of the Higgs is equal to what? Well, I'm going to use the expression that was here and I just canceled because I was not thinking about what I needed. So this is d mu capital H. Then I have plus I g divided by square root of 2 t plus w mu plus h. Then I have the same thing with the minus. So I g divided by square root of 2 t minus W minus mu H, and then I have plus E Q A is a factor of I H, and then I have the last term, which is G square plus G prime square T3 left minus SW square Q Z, I forgot the Z. Also here, let me put the mu applied on H. Okay. And let me remind you that since the Higgs doublet is a doublet, we know what is the expression for T plus, T minus, Q, and T3, right? So T plus is the matrix 0, 1, 0, 0. T minus is the Hermitian conjugate of this. So this it is 0, 0, 1, 0. T3 is simply equal to 1 half 0, 0 minus 1 half, and Q is equal to 0, 0, 0 minus 1. Q is equal to plus 1, 0, 0, 0. Okay. This follow immediately from the fact that you need to sum this with something of with hypercharge, which is equal to plus 1 half. So you see that this component, when you sum the identity multiplied by 1 half, this component goes to 0, this one goes to plus 1. Okay, so let's write this in a matrix form. And let me also do the computation in unitary range, so that the Higgs doublet is simply equal to 0 V plus V the Higgs particle divided by square root of k. So here I get the first term is very easy, right? Because it's the derivative of here. So it is simply equal to zero dH divided by the square root of two. Then let me write all these matrix elements. So here, I then multiply what? Well, here I get off diagonal g divided by square root of 2 w plus, and here I get g divided by square root of 2 w minus. Okay, then I have the electric charge, which is here. So this is EA, okay, on this first entry here. And then I get this one, and this one is equal to what? So this one has a component in the first entry, which is plus the square root of g squared plus g prime. Well, let me write it bigger. So let me start from the four. So this is E A. Then I have the Z boson. So this is plus square root of G squared plus G prime squared divided by two, because this is the three left, minus, so actually let me write this. So it is vector 1/2 minus SW squared times this, which is this second term here. Okay. Then the 1-2 component is G over square root of 2 W plus. The 2-1 component is simply G over square root of 2 W minus. And then the 2-2 component doesn't see the electric charge because you see that the electric charge is equal to zero. So it only sees the third generator of SU2. So it is this one with minus the square root of g squared plus g prime squared divided by 2 because of this. Okay. And all this is applied on 0 v plus h divided by square root of 2. Okay. So let's do this matrix multiplication now. So let me cancel up, let me clean up a bit this part here of the board. And also, I will write here. Okay. So now, or actually, let me write it down here. You see, can you see here? Yes. So this is going to be 0 dH divided by square root of 2. And now I'm going to perform this matrix multiplication. Okay. So this is plus I. Now, this acts on 0 and gives 0. This sees this term. So this is G W plus divided by square root of 2. And let me put outside this term because it's going to be common. Now, this term sees zero, and this one sees, I forgot the zero. And this one sees this, the non vanishing term. So this is minus the square root of g squared plus g prime squared z divided by. Okay. And this is, you see, that now we have something interesting, which is apparent. The photon doesn't know anything about the Higgs, because you see that in working in unitary gauge, we are able to put to zero this first component, and the photon only sees the first component. This is not the case, right? Because you remember that the physical Higgs is along the direction which is unbroken. So Q, the electric charge, applied on the unbroken direction, gives zero, right? By definition of what the unbroken direction is. So very good. So this is the covariant derivative. So if you want, now we can take the mod square of this term. So to compute this one, so let me write it here. So this is the real part. This is the imaginary part because there is a factor of I here. They do not interfere, right? So I need to take the square of this and the square of this. So the square of the first term is the Higgs particle kinetic term. So it's very good. This particle is propagating. Then here I get plus G square W plus W minus divided by 2. And then from here I get plus G square plus G prime square divided by 4 Z square, and all these terms multiplied by V plus H divided by square root of 2 square. Okay, so this is the square of this vector. So you see that it took this by itself, this by itself multiplied by this term square, this by itself multiplied by this square square. So these are the value steps. So let me take this value, this V, this verb, let me factorize it from this parenthesis and let me include it in this other parenthesis. Okay, and now we're gonna see why I'm doing this trick. So when I factorize from here, the factor of V square exits, because this is everything, all this is square, right? So I can be included here. And what I get is G square V square divided by 2, W plus mu, W minus mu, plus G square plus G prime square V square divided by 4, Z mu square. And all this term is multiplied by 1 plus h divided by square root of 2 v square. So what do we discover from this? Well, there are various things that we can read from here. So first of all, when I open up the square, you see that I get a factor of 1. Then I get a factor which is quadratic in h, which is h squared divided by 2 times v squared. And then I have the double product, which is equal to square root of 2 h divided by v. So there is a term which contains 2 Higgs bosons, another that contains 1 Higgs boson, and one that doesn't contain an Higgs boson. So let's start focusing on this one. Since this doesn't contain an Higgs boson, you see that this is a term which is quadratic in the gauge bosons. So this is a must term. So this one allows me to read directly what are the masses of the W and of the Z boson, because this is the W mass square, and this is the Z mass square divided by 2. Divided by 2 because Z is real, while W is a complex object, okay? So remember that there is the factor of 2 of difference that we saw many times. So let me write the result here because this is of capital importance. So mw square is equal to g square v square divided by 2, and mz square is slightly larger because it's equal to g square plus g prime square divided by 2, everything by v square. So you're going to see from here that the only difference between the w and the z mass is due to g prime. Okay, so if g prime is not too large, we expect the masses of the w and the z boson to be relatively similar. Now, if you go back to lecture zero and you see actually the table with the masses, you're going to discover that actually they're not so different, right? The W mass is 80.4 GeV and the Z mass is 91 GeV. So they're quite similar actually. And the difference is precisely due to this G prime. Okay. So from here, we have a prediction is the following. Let me take the mass of the Z. No, actually, sorry. Let me take the mass of the W square divided by the mass of the Z square. So you see that this object, when I take this divided by this, is equal to G square divided by G square plus G prime square. So you see that now, if I divide here by the cosine square of the weak angle, I am dividing precisely by this object. So here is 1 over C square W, and this is equal to 1. Okay, so there is this combination of parameters, which is precisely equal to 1. So this combination of parameters takes a specific name. It's called the rho parameter. Okay. We're going to say something more about this rho parameter because this is very important. So this is actually a parameter that is going to appear in the Fermi-Lagrange. We will get back and we will rederive the Fermi-Lagrange from the standard model in a few lectures. And we're going to see that this rho parameter is actually appearing there. It's measuring the relative importance of the terms generated by the Z and the terms generated by the W. And what's more important is that experimentally, this rho parameter is measured to be very close to one, okay? And actually the deviation from the rho parameter, we are going to see that there will be deviations from the rho parameter predicted in standard model. These are corrections that arise at loop level, okay? So that's why we're not seeing them in this computation. But those corrections perfectly account for the small mismatch, for a small experimental mismatch that is measured between one and experimental value. Okay, so this is the first prediction that the standard model is giving us, and it is actually confirmed experimental. Okay, but we're gonna get back to this one. So perfect. So now we know how to compute the W and the Z masses. Let me just notice that from here we have a quadrilinear term between two H's and two W's and two H's and two Z's, and a linear term between H and W and H and Z. And all these interactions are proportional to the gauge boson masses. Okay. So we start to see a property of the Higgs boson that is actually a general property. Since the Higgs, because of the structure of electric symmetry breaking, since the Higgs boson is giving mass, XW is giving mass to the particles, the remnant of this action of giving mass is manifesting itself as the fact that the Higgs particle couples with other particles with a strength which is proportional to the other particle mass. Okay, so this is something interesting, and it has been experimentally confirmed up to experimental errors. Okay, I'm going to show you in the future, we're going to discuss more about the Higgs particle, and I'm going to show you what is the current stages. Okay, very good. So let me close here in this lecture, since we already discussed many things. Next lecture, we're going to start again from the Higgs potential. So we're going to see how to connect the parameters in the Higgs potential to the VEV and the Higgs mass. And we're also going to discuss what happens with the Yukawa Lagrange. So once more, thank you for your attention and see you next time.